People often say that truth is stranger than fiction, and every now and then, a true story comes to light that almost defies belief. Such is the life story of Tony Anthony, who, as a four-year-old boy, was taken from his parents in London to live with his grandfather in China. His grandfather, a kung fu grandmaster, trains Tony in the art of Shaolin monk traditions of kung fu. After many trials and much suffering, Tony eventually becomes the world kung fu champion. As time passes, Tony is invited to work for the International Kung Fu Federation, an elite bodyguard organization protecting some of the world's richest and most powerful people.
Instead of shooting somebody in their shoulder or their leg to disarm them, instead I would shoot to kill. I would shoot them straight in the face.
Then, tragedy strikes, and Tony falls into a downward spiral of self-destruction, which turns him into a bloodthirsty and violent gangster. Tony is subsequently incarcerated into the notorious Nikosia Central Prison, where he finds every form of human depravity.
Day-to-day life in the Nikosia Central Prison was very, very hard. You know, you had to watch your back because there wasn't much segregation happening. You know, you had rapists and paedophiles and terrorists and murderers and thieves and people in there just for like visa problems. You know, all mixed together. The only segregation that you had was a separate block where people had mental illness. You know, and even though they were kept separate, they had an open gate policy from their rooms, their little, you know. And they could wander anywhere in the prison, and they'll walk around with blades, and you know, they'll hide it under their tongue or maybe behind their ear, you know, or they'll just carry it. They couldn't carry less anyway, and neither did the prison officers. Or they'll have makeshift knives, and they'll come up to you and they'll cut you on the face or the back, or stab you, you know, just to nick a cigarette from you, you know, or even for no reason at all. And every day was a day for self-preservation, because there'll be people doing horrible things to each other in this place. And so from day one, you know, I was very violent. And you had to show to the other prisoners that you weren't going to take any nonsense, whether they were in control of their minds or not. And, you know, some people got very badly cut up and beaten up and, you know, or kicked in. And really, it was, you just had to watch your own back, you know. There were some people that came to the prison. There was one person in particular, an English guy called Martin, and he was a journalist. And when he came here, he was just a weak man, and he was very nervous. And I was glad to have made a friend with him, because at least I could help to just keep him safe, you know, because other people would have taken advantage very easily. You know, three of your lifelines that keep you sane in a prison is the people you might be able to phone, if you're allowed to use the telephone, the people that visit you, and the people that obviously write letters to you. And, you know, none of my friends or my family wrote a single letter to me, and none of them wanted to come and see me because I was bad news. I was a disgusting, filthy attitude, and I deserved to be treated in that way, you know. Most of the other people, mainly the locals, the Greek people, they were visited by their friends, their families, their girlfriends and their children, which was lovely. But for me, I had no visitors. But the one thing that really spoke into my life was I got this letter from a complete stranger. My own friends and family couldn't be bothered to write to me or visit me, and I deserved that. But this stranger wrote to me, and that really spoke into my life. And this man was also visiting an English soldier called Andy, and he wanted to come and visit me, and then began these weekly visits, week after week after month after month after year.
The first thing I knew about Tony was when I got a visiting card in the post box. For this person that I didn't know much about, although I had had warning because Andy, who I had been visiting in the prison already, had said that there was someone else that was interested in just someone to come and visit him. And I had said I was happy enough, so it was that visiting card, a little small square card that comes in the post. But I was always happy to see a card. When I found this one, it was for someone called Tony Anthony.
Michael Wright came to visit me on a regular basis, and one of the most amazing things was that he was consistent. He had integrity, and when he said he was going to come and visit me the next week, he was going to come and visit me. And he always wrote letters to me, and you know, he shared with me about the thing that was the most important thing in his life. And he told me that was Jesus Christ. Now for me, I had no concept of this at all, because I was a Buddhist. I did not believe in God. I had got myself so down the wrong road in life, I became violent and aggressive, and here I was in this prison. But I took on that message of hope, the fact that, you know, that people even as lost as me can be transformed from the inside and out by knowing Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Yes, I read there in the newspaper that he had been there for burglaries. He had done burglaries, he was up for that, and various thefts. There wasn't a lot of detail, there wasn't a lot of information in the newspaper about it. But mainly for burglaries in big houses and such like that, and he had been caught by the police.
I was very moved by Michael Wright's visits, because he never judged me once. Normally the first thing a prisoner is asked is, what have you done to be in prison? How long are you serving? And all these sorts of details. They want the gory details. Whereas Michael, he was not interested in that. He was interested in something far deeper than that. And he wasn't trying to convert me, but he was like, it's like a beggar. He was like a beggar that's found some food, and he's wanting to share it with another beggar, and that's me.
And first time I went in and saw Tony Anthony, in one sense, I didn't have any pre-expectations. He was just someone that I wanted to befriend, and someone that I wanted, that I knew was probably lonely enough that didn't have visitors. And that would have showed right from the beginning that he didn't have anyone there. Now, also, I know that one of the things, like the other prisoner that I was visiting too, was that I could provide him with a Coca-Cola and something to eat. That even in that, I knew by this time that even that was something that they didn't get when they were on inside. They only got that in the visiting room.
You know, Charles Spurgeon once said that evangelism is one beggar telling another beggar where to find food. And for me, that's what Michael was doing. He was just sharing this food with me. And the food was a spiritual food. It wasn't a food of this world. So I didn't recognize it. And when I heard it, it was refreshing for me. And it spoke into my life, and the words had power over me. And these are the words of the Bible. These are the words of God. And these are the words which began to change me. That key verse in the Bible in John chapter 8, verse 36. So if the Son of God sets you free, you shall be free indeed. These are the words from a page in a Bible, and yet they had power in my life.
At the beginning, Tony had no option. When I came as me, and my life is Christ. He's all of my life. So though I was coming as a friend, just to share with him a friend, that meant sharing my life. It meant sharing what was important to me. I did get permission, not immediately, but after a while I did get permission to take my Bible into the visiting room. And when I had my Bible with me, well then we had to open the Bible and share what was there, because that was what was real to me, that was what was important to me. I think Tony got to know that very quickly. If he wanted just to talk about other things, that was okay. But if we were to become friends, my life had to come into it as well. And my life was God and His Word.
This prison here is, in many ways, is a bit like this scar here on my arm. This scar, it looks a bit ugly, but it's me. This is me. It doesn't hurt me anymore. And I need this part of me, you know? And for me, this place represented a lot of horror and pain and suffering in my life and in other people's lives that I inflicted. But this is the place where I was born again into a brand new person. This is like my birthplace, and for me, I've got a mixture of two feelings. One is my heart's beating, panic, walking into a place like this again. And the other one is like joy. And tears are almost running. I feel them coming to my eyes because my life was changed here. And if I hadn't gone here, and if I hadn't encountered Jesus Christ through Michael Wright, I would probably be dead today. but I'm alive because God's changed my life, and this place represents that is in many ways like the hospital where I was born.
Tony, in one sense at the beginning, Tony was just one of many that I visited, and was just a person that I was happy to befriend. Now he did become a very close friend as time went on, but that was it. My heart was to, in befriending people, to share the freedom that I had got myself from getting to know Christ. So that was my burden, also to put that across. But it was more than that. I wanted to befriend those who I knew that Christ was the only answer.
Cyprus is a lovely island to come to for so many people, for its beaches, its sun. It's a lovely place to be. Great food. But for me, my experience of Cyprus is very different. For me, it's being in this prison here, Nikosia Central Prison, a place where every month people will get very badly beaten up or cut up or gang raped or even killed. My experience has been very different.
I think, when I think back, I think of the day that Tony was released. That actually was a sad day for me. I know it was a good day and a happy day for Tony, but it was a sad day for me because I lost physical contact or visual contact of a friend because he had become a friend. Meeting him back here now after so many years, and we have met once or one or two other times in other places, but every time I meet him it's a reunion of good friends. We do keep in contact, so the friendship continues, but physically meeting and visually meeting each other, that's special. We have been since almost the first few times that I visited him, we have been very good friends, and that friendship has deepened and strengthened as the years. It helps that we are brothers in Christ. That helps to deepen that friendship. But Tony is special to me, and I feel he's that I'm special to him. We are good friends. We've been involved in his life, in praying for him, keeping an eye on what's happening. And we also had the privilege of being there at his wedding and of performing the wedding ceremony. And that was very special for me. I would say my relationship with Tony and all what I know of Tony is built up in a strong friendship, as well as being family together in Christ.
What did you think of this evening?
I thought it was mind-blowing. I think it was a wonderful experience.
I thought it was absolutely fantastic.
It's really amazing.
Absolutely fantastic.
Awesome.
It was great.
Terrific, absolutely terrific.
I think I was just struck at how God can just break into people's lives.
Yeah, for me, that message this evening, it was one of the most humble that I've really heard.
And it was really challenging, but at the same time really simple. To see the God who loves us and sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on that cross for us.
Actually, I'm a Chinese, and I'm not a Christian at all.
I was so impacted tonight by the realness of the man that I was just so touched. It was amazing.
It just firmly make me believe in God.
Yeah. That's the kind of message that we need, is the real God that changes real people.
There's a God who lives in heaven, who's your dad, who loves you. It doesn't matter what you've done, he's there to pick you up and give you a hug and say, welcome my son, my daughter.
It's a God of second chances.
Yeah, exactly.
Is that what you found?
Yep, second and third and fourth. A God of grace who loves us and just wants us to be in a relationship with him.
I enjoyed Tony's testimony, and I enjoyed Angela just setting the scene.
To be honest, I've got to be honest, I actually didn't want to do his book. I'm a mum to two young children, and that's what I was content doing. But I had a call from the publisher, who I've worked with before, and he said, look, we've got this amazing guy, fantastic story, but he needs somebody to write it. And I really believe that there's no way I could be the right person to do that. But he's, you know, after a while, he said, well, just come and meet Tony and see what happens. And that's what I did. We met, and he shared something of his story, just a small part of it, some of what you'll hear tonight. And I was just so compelled by it, and I thought, you know, if God allows, then, you know, it's going to be a huge privilege to work on this project.
How did you pull back from the gruesome bits, you know, the really brutal bits in the book, because there are many, many brutal things that happen during Tony's life.
There are. One of the key aims with the book, and I'm sure Tony would say this, is the last thing, the very last thing we wanted to do was glorify the violence. And I know Tony is very aware that when he goes around giving his story, there are a group of people that will come along because they want to hear the gruesome details. They might want to see a kung fu demonstration. They want to hear the blood and the gore. And that's probably a natural thing. I think there's something within all of us that kind of is attracted to that kind of thing. So it was something to be handled very sensitively.
How did you manage to draw out of Tony stories about his youth, about his childhood? Because those were very, very traumatic, and it must have been very, very difficult to draw that from him.
It was at times. He doesn't tell his story easily. In the last couple of years, I think Tony would tell you he's been all around the world, and he's now very used to giving his story, but I think it pains him a great deal. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying this. And at the time when we met and he was going through these details, and of course I was having to really, you know, drag more detail out, it was a very, very painful experience for him. So again, that was something that I had to be sensitive to. It took a little time, but I think we got there in the end.
Finally, Angela, what do you think, the last question now, what do you think the lasting impression of people is normally when they read this book?
Probably amazement. A lot of people say, is it really true? You know, did he really go through all that? Because as you said in the beginning, it is a bit like a James Bond story, a film or something. But the lasting impression has to be for the gospel message. And I know that's certainly what Tony and then my intention was when we wrote this book. The gospel message is very clear in there. And that's what the lasting impression has to be.